On this flight, I'm going to be testing Starlink up in the air. All right, maybe not this flight. It's going to be flying on JSX. Let's go.
Because JSX doesn't fly out of my local favorite Long Beach airport, I had to drive almost an hour away to Burbank, where I pulled up directly to the hangar where the plane was waiting just outside. Walking in was quick and easy. Instead of the traditional TSA setup, it just tested my bag for explosives. Not exactly first-class lounge, but a nice place to rest while you wait for your flight. Honestly, you shouldn't be spending that much time in here because you can show up to your flight 20 minutes early, check in, and board the plane with no issues.
I had a little time to kill, so I figured I'd sit down and test how the Wi-Fi was in the terminal using their terrestrial internet, meaning fiber internet installed in their building, and compare it to the internet that I would have whilst sitting on the plane on the tarmac, as well as flying at 30,000 feet through the air. After a few short minutes of testing out the Wi-Fi in the lounge, I quickly switched to hotspot. Interestingly enough, the Wi-Fi in here is terrible. I'm expecting a completely different experience on the plane. All right, time to board.
Boarding on the Vander Pumps edition.
For those who have not flown on JSX, which I imagine is most of you, the planes are cramped but comfortable. That being said, I was seated next to a big guy about my size, and we weren't particularly cramped. It was comfortable. Looking around the aircraft at your traditional amenities, the seats were wider, although on my seat, my tray table came down and was a bit wobbly and didn't actually pull towards me, which was a little annoying because of the amount of legroom you have. But that's not why you're watching this video, so let's get to the actual Starlink experience. While waiting for everyone to finish boarding, I decided to see how Starlink would perform on the ground. The speeds were nothing to write home about, usually about 10 meg down. That's still much better than I would get on any other aircraft whilst flying through the air, but those speeds were still significantly better than what I was getting sitting in their terminal on a traditional Wi-Fi. Once we got in the air, however, things started to get interesting. As the plane was rolling down the runway, I was furiously doing speed test after speed test to see how the performance would change. And honestly, it was rock solid.
I actually hit speeds upwards of 60 meg down and 12 up as we were taxiing down the runway and taking off. Unfortunately, the speeds I was getting in the air near SpaceX headquarters, which would have been really nice to have for the whole flight, were not meant to last.
Things started to get a little jittery once we hit 10,000 and we were really moving. It felt almost as the Starlink dish on the top of the plane was working to acquire the best satellites as it was moving through and switching between base stations. Now notice on my speed test that I'm showing up in Dallas, Texas, whereas I took off from Southern California. For those wondering, I did not, however, get the chance to go and check to see if inappropriate material was going to be allowed on the network, as it was a short hop and the flight was over before I knew it. Next, of course, being a YouTuber, I opened up YouTube to see what it would be like to stream a video that I had never before loaded on my computer. I clicked, and the way I usually watch videos is in full 4K at 2x speed, so I immediately selected those settings, and that's when the trouble began. It had issues smoothly playing a 4K video, especially at 2x, and even when I slowed it down to 1x, the normal speed, it still had to buffer for a long time in order to get a few seconds of video out before buffering again. However, when I switched down to 1440, even at 2x speeds, it worked just fine. I also tried out video calling while I was on board to see how well it worked and if it was allowed. It was allowed, and it worked quite well, but I got a whole bunch of dirty looks, so I'm not entirely sure it was worth it. Additionally, I had to shout pretty loudly to get over the sound of the aircraft, because unlike your normal planes, this plane was loud. I think I clocked in the loudness on my noise meter on my Apple Watch at about 80 or 90 decibels, which is quite loud when you're trying to talk over the noise of the plane and have a phone call, whilst also not disturbing the people around you. In the end, I told them I would call them when I landed because, quite frankly, I didn't feel comfortable continuing. I will add, however, that this is the first time ever that upon landing, I did not immediately turn off Wi-Fi and turn on cellular data on my phone so that I could have a much more normal functional Wi-Fi, because the Wi-Fi on board was really quite good. It actually took until I was getting off the plane for me to realize, oh, I should probably do that now. That being said, JSX did actually highlight video calling as one of the advantages of them having and using Starlink in the sky.
All right, got to Oakland. Super easy getting off the plane. Walked right off and my luggage was waiting there for me. I took a minute to look around and enjoy the scenery standing on an active jetway, and what did I see? The Starlink jet itself. I tried to go over closer and get a picture, but they would only let me get so close, so this is what I was able to get. Now back to the studio to answer some community questions.
When is Starlink Wi-Fi available? Can you use it in the terminal? Well, I had hoped that this was the case, given that the plane was sitting just outside the hangar. I was not able to connect to the Wi-Fi until I got on board. They must have those Wi-Fi radios pretty low powered. However, as soon as I was on board, I was able to connect with all of my devices and start using it immediately. What does it cost, and was there a captive portal when you're logging in? The Starlink onboard Wi-Fi is totally free, and there was no captive portal. I just connected to the network, which was unlocked and open, and away I went. There are a few other larger carriers getting set up with Starlink Aviation over the next several months, and I'm curious to see how they're going to handle having a lot more people on the same connection. I spent a lot of time working with Starlink, both on Starlink Business and Starlink Residential, and the speeds I was getting on board were not quite as good as I'd come to expect from Starlink, and the latency was significantly higher than I would have hoped. That being said, latency is continuously being brought down, and the technology is continuing to improve. All the metrics and numbers aside, when I stopped testing it and just tried to do some work outside of watching YouTube at 4K 2X speeds, and just do my email, do regular browsing, write this script, I didn't even notice. It was almost as if I was on my Wi-Fi at home. So how would I score this? Well, compared to other plain Wi-Fis, I'd give this 1,000 because even when you pay for it on other providers, half the time the internet doesn't even work, and when it does, it's so slow and so throttled, it's hardly usable. Now compared to my 1 gig fiber Wi-Fi at home, no, it's not gonna be anywhere near as good. And upload speed is gonna be terrible, especially if you're somebody like me who's trying to upload large files or YouTube videos, for example. That being said, as far as using the Wi-Fi in the air, I 100% recommend it and would use it again and wish every airline would adopt this and look forward to the future where this speed continues to get even faster, latency gets even lower and much more reliable, and we're able to have this effect on any airline in the world. If you like more interesting stories like this, please hit the subscribe, drop your questions and comments below, and I'll do my best to answer them. Thanks for watching.